6.7 conservation of mass, Wednesday, January 15th. Without a conservation of mass, many of the materials that we use in everyday life wouldn't function as they do. And that's because chemical reactions would be unstable if mass weren't balanced. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. The references that you'll need for this lesson include the periodic table, which gives atomic masses of elements. And please note that anytime you see text in red during this lesson, I want you to memorize this information. First, let's talk about something called the conservation of mass, energy, and charge. The conservation of mass, energy, and charge states one fundamental thing. In all chemical reactions, energy, mass, and charge are conserved, meaning they're basically kept the same. And these three quantities are neither created nor destroyed, but instead they're converted from one form to another. So they're changed from one form to another. So mass, energy, and charge stay the same on both the products and the reactant side. Alright, so one thing I want you to note is that the mass of reactants equals the mass of products in all reactions. Also, the energy of reactants equals the energy of products in all reactants. Also, the charge of reactants equals the charge of products in all reactions. So just note that these three, mass, energy, and charge, are the same on both sides of a reaction in all reactions you have. So these three are kept the same on both sides. You never lose or gain anything. It's just the same thing no matter what. All right? The same amount, but they're just different types, but they're still the same amount. Now let's talk about something we'll be focusing on this lesson called missing mass in equations. Basically, the missing mass of a substance can always be found if you solve for it. We're going to call this X throughout the lesson, but you'll see that in the next slide. All right, but all I need to remember for this lesson is that the mass of reactants, which is before the arrow, equals the mass of products, which comes after the arrow. So the mass of reactants equals the mass of products. The masses don't change, just the different types of substances do. But the actual mass, which is the amount of something that there is, doesn't change at all. The mass stays the same on both sides. That's why mass of reactants equals mass of products. Now let's talk about how to solve problems involving mass. This involves a four-step process. What I want you to do first is write the mass of each reactant and or product that is given. So these masses will actually be given to you. All I want you to do is write the masses literally right underneath each reactant and product as they're given to you in the problem. Ignore the coefficients. Don't worry about them. Don't multiply anything. Don't do any of that. All you have to do is write the mass that you're given under each reactant and each product. Next, number two, I want you to write X as the mass of the unknown species. So anywhere where they don't give you the mass of something, write it as X. And again, ignore all coefficients. You don't need to do that. Just write the unknown mass as X. And the masses you just write as they're given to you. Step three, you have to set up an equation as follows. So the total mass of the reactants, which is the masses added up on the left side of the arrow, equals the total mass of the product, which is the total mass on the right side of the arrow. Alright, so once you set everything equal to each other along with X, in step four, finally, I want you to solve for what X actually is. And this is a lot of just like algebra. You seem to solve for X. It's mostly just addition and subtraction. So let's actually see that with an example here. This example asks us the following question. If 103.0 grams of potassium chlorate is decomposed to form 62.7 grams of potassium chloride and oxygen gas, how many grams of oxygen are formed? So from this problem, we automatically note that we have 103.0 grams of potassium chlorate, since potassium chlorate is over here. And we also know that we have 62.7 grams of potassium chloride. So we write 62.7 grams under KCl. However, the problem asks how many grams of oxygen gas are formed. So we know that the grams of oxygen gas formed are known as X. All right, so KClO3 is potassium chlorate, and we know we have 103.0 grams. For KCl or potassium chloride, we have 62.7 grams according to the question. And we know that oxygen gas, its mass is known as X. So what we can do now is we write X as the mass of the unknown species. All right, so we know 103.0 grams is for KClO3 or potassium chlorate. We know that 62.7 grams is for potassium chloride or KCl, and we know that X is the mass of O2 or oxygen gas. All right, step three, we have to set up an equation that makes the total mass of the reactants equal to the total mass of the products. So we know that the only reactant is KClO3 and its mass is 103.0 grams. All right, so we know that equals the total mass of the products. The two products are KCl, which has a mass of 62.7, and we also have oxygen gas, whose mass is X. So these two are the products, so we add up their masses. So 103.0 grams equals 62.7 grams plus X. All right, finally, in step four, we just need to solve for X, basically get X by itself. So what we can do there is we can subtract 62.7 from both sides and we can solve for X. So X, or the mass of oxygen, equals 103.0 grams minus 62.7 grams. And therefore, we know that X is equal to 40.3 grams. So we know that the mass of oxygen is 40.3 grams. That's it. Now let's try an example using what we know, example one. This question asks, what mass of carbon dioxide will be produced if 144 grams of carbon reacts with 384 grams of oxygen gas? And the reaction for this is CS plus O2G gives you CO2G. So let's just break this down. Our reactants are carbon, as noted here, and also oxygen gas, which is noted here. And our product is carbon dioxide or CO2, which is noted right here. So all we need to do now, as a solution is basically plug everything in based on what the problem gives us. All right, so we know we have 144 grams of carbon. So for C, we know we have 144.0 grams of C. We also know we have 384 grams of oxygen gas, so we have 384 grams of O2. These are the reactants. And let's remember we have to set the total mass of the reactants equal to the total mass of the products. All right, so 144.0 grams C plus 384 grams of O2 has to equal X grams of CO2. And the only reason why we wrote X grams of CO2 is because we don't know how many grams of CO2 there are. That's what we're trying to figure out, the mass of carbon dioxide. Now, if we add up 144 and 384, we get 528 grams total. And that equals X, or the total mass of the product side, which is the mass of CO2. So therefore, since we know X equals 528, we know that there are 528 grams of carbon dioxide, since 528 equals the total of these two masses added up together. That's it. Now let's try an example using what we know, example problem one. This problem asks a 6.35 gram sample of Cu reacts with AgCH3CO to form 15.62 grams of CuCH3CO2 and 6.12 grams of Ag according to the following reaction. So we have Cu plus AgCH3COO gives you CuCH3COO2 plus Ag. And our question asks us to find the total mass of AgCH3COO that reacted. So all we need to do is just plug in all of the numbers that we have. We know we have 6.35 grams of Cu, so we plug that in for Cu. And it reacts with AgCH3COO. Now, we know we have 15.62 grams of CuCH3COO2, so we put this on the right side or on the product side. And we know we have 6.12 grams of Ag, so we put that on the product side or the right side of the arrow. Finally, we know that we need to find the mass of AgCH3COO, so we put that as X. So this mass, which is 6.35 grams, plus this mass, which is X, equals the total of this mass, which is 13.62 grams, plus this mass, which is 6.12 grams. If we just simplify the equation, we get 6.35 plus X gives you 21.74 grams. And if we solve for X, which is the mass of AgCH3COO, we get X equals 21.74 minus 6.35 grams, which is 15.39 grams. So therefore, since X equals 15.39 grams, The total mass of AgCH3COO that reacted was 15.39 grams. In B, the quantities that are conserved or kept the same in all chemical reactions are mass, energy, and charge. So mass, energy, and charge are conserved in all chemical reactions. They're kept the same on both sides, both on the left side, which is the reactant side, and also on the right side, which is the product side. Finally, in C, how does this reaction show the conservation of mass? Well, this question asks how this reaction shows the conservation of mass. And basically, the conservation mass already tells us that the masses of the reactants equals the masses of the products. So the mass is conserved on both sides of the reactions. So basically, the mass is kept the same. The reactant's mass total is equal to the product's mass total. So the mass is kept the same or conserved on both sides. It doesn't change the amount. It may change what it is, but it won't change how much of it there is. The amount is the same, the form may look slightly different. That's it. Finally, I'd like for you to try this on your own and bring it in for Wednesday, January 15th. Thank you very much.